KETV Newswatch 7, chronicling the stories impacting our community. Stories making a difference. Stories that matter to you. This is KETV Newswatch 7's Chronicle.
It's time to put Americans to work and to become more energy independent here in America.
I'm here to tell you there's a silent majority of people in the hills of northeast Nebraska that want this built.
It's a good opportunity for all of our members to be able to go to work, pay their bills, pay their taxes, buy the fuel, buy groceries, and just raise their families.
Created a lot of jobs at a time when the economy was very bad. You know, crop prices aren't good this year. We could use this boost. This pipeline will be built in 2018 using the best technology, the newest resources, the best pumping stations.
Well, whether it's speaking out about the proposed Keystone XL pipeline or simply marching in the annual September Fest parade, labor has had a long, rich history in Omaha.
We had tens of thousands of people here today, all the way up along the lines. It's wall to wall, as you can see. We're very proud of it.
It's because of organized labor. We have 40-hour work weeks. We have weekends. We have child labor laws.
History has shown that we're better off when the rights of workers is protected.
And this morning on Chronicle, we're taking an in-depth look at the history of labor in America, where things stand, and what the future may hold. Well, good morning. I'm Rob McCartney. Thanks for joining us on this Labor Day weekend. Now, we decided to do this show after hearing about a labor shortage in Omaha. Even during the worst of the most recent recession, Nebraska's unemployment rate was among the lowest in the country. It's currently 2.8% statewide, just a little higher in the Omaha Council Bluffs Metro, 3.1%. But that's still among the lowest in all of America. Now, for the past 40 years, the city has held Septemberfest. That's a salute to labor. It's currently underway in Lot D at the CenturyLink Center. But the celebration is about a lot more than just carnival rides and barbecue. See, if you walk along the river, you'll find another salute to labor. This famous statue is created by Matt Plotcheck. It's the second largest tribute to labor in America. Walk a little further, you will see a number of plaques. There are 29 of them, to be exact, each representing the dozens of unions calling Omaha home. So, what do people think of unions? A recent Gallup poll asked, do you approve or disapprove of unions? As you can see, support has remained pretty consistent, but it hit its peak back in 1957. And as you might imagine, among the two major political parties, there is a sharp divide on whether they approve or disapprove of unions. A majority of Republicans disapprove. Almost 80% of Democrats approve of them. Which leads us to President Donald Trump and his very public dispute with a union leader in Indiana shortly after he was elected. Of course, the central platforms of the president's campaign was to make America great again by bringing jobs back to the U.S. And just before Christmas, President Trump intervened and stopped a carrier plant in Indiana from moving to Mexico.
He didn't tell the truth. He inflated the numbers, and I called him out on it.
Chuck Jones, president of United Steelworkers 1999, wasn't happy with Mr. Trump taking credit for saving 1,000 jobs. Jones says 800 jobs were saved, but hundreds more were not. In fact, another 600 employees lost their jobs this past May.
They did not mention anything about 550 jobs here in Indianapolis going to Mexico.
Now, President Trump blasted Jones on Twitter, writing he's, quote, done a terrible job representing workers. No wonder companies flee the country. Following that with, if United Steelworkers 1999 was any good, they would have kept those jobs in Indiana. All right, so all that said, where do labor unions stand today? What does the future hold? Joining us now to answer those questions and more is John Kretschmar. He is director of the William Brennan Institute for Labor Studies at UNO. John, thanks for much for coming in this morning. So folks who don't know, give us a brief history of labor unions. Where'd they start?
Most people don't appreciate it, but unions in this country date back to the colonial period. The large port cities of America had large employers, and their employees formed labor unions even back then. Hmm. Although it took, we had to wait until 1870 when half of the workforce actually worked, sold their labor to somebody else to earn a living, and during the Gilded Age, that's when unions started coming on strong. Again in the 1930s, another big boom lasting through World War II, And the 1957 date that you give, it is interesting that both Republicans and Democrats were very supportive of unions back in that era.
Why was it so big in 57? Was it the post-World War II push? What?
We have the post-World War II push. Coming out of World War II, the numbers were great. And unions were seen as an equal partner along with business and government. It was a three-legged stool in terms of setting public policy. And that lasted until about the mid-1970s, and then things started to turn quite different.
Why is that?
Public policy. The notion, there's an article from 1974 in Business Week where the writer says, things are changing. In the old days, for every increased percentage in productivity, there was a corresponding increase in wages. So it's a one-for-one. By 1974, the fellow who wrote in Business Week said, those days are over. You know, the workforce is going to have to learn to do more with less, to sacrifice so that investors will be able to get more of the profits.
You know, public opinion usually drives policy, not the other way around. So what changed to change the public's view to force the policy?
That's a good I would argue that one of the main players was a memo that was written in 1971 to the U.S. Chamber of Commerce by a fellow named Lewis Powell. He said the youth of America is disappointed with where the country is going in terms of the war, in terms of the civil rights movement, in terms of some of the other women's movement, in terms of their attitude towards capital and big business. And he said, we need to turn that around. And he suggested to the chamber that they find wealthy investors who will start creating think tanks, conservative think tanks. And so we get the Heritage Institute, we get the Cato Institute, we get the what we now call ALEC, all coming out of that. And I think that Nebraska's Platt Institute is like the grandchild of that stuff.
So that's a history. Now we go to today. Nebraska, Iowa, they are two of the, 28 states that are right-to-work states where people can't be forced to join a union.
Right.
Good law, bad law?
It's an interesting frame. Because the part that is unsaid, of course, is that unions must represent everybody in the bargaining unit equally well, whereas only a few of those people have to pay their fair share towards the cost of that representation. Anytime you get something for nothing, there is a problem. And so our non-union brothers and sisters in the American labor movement in those right-to-work states have some education ahead of them, because I don't believe they fully understand what unions are and what they do.
Gotcha. If you belong to a union, what should you expect?
Well, unions exist for one purpose only. They exist to introduce meaningful workplace into the meaningful democracy. Boy, getting tongue-tied. Yeah, into the workplace. So that collectively you can work with management, because the contracts that are negotiated are jointly agreed to. You work with management to raise levels of fairness and justice above the levels management left to its own devices would establish on its own.
Gotcha. One of the key moments for unions is the negotiations,
right?
Going to the table. Right. Walk me through what that's like, sitting at the table.
Well, a collectively bargained contract is legally binding for its duration, right? So what you're doing by introducing a contract is you are setting up the standards that will be followed for 3 years or 5 years, depending on how long it goes. And both labor and management have to live by those. The negotiations themselves can go from being very smooth to kind of rough. Mm-hmm. Rough ones don't happen all that often. Unions keep in mind in negotiations that you never want to kill the goose that lays the golden egg, right? So you have to be able to look at what the employer can afford. And if employers are unable to afford what the union is asking for, the employers under the National Labor Relations Act have the ability to actually show the books to the unions, and then the unions can say, yeah, we're asking for too much, we don't want to hurt you. And in Nebraska, in Omaha, dating back to a grocery store called Shavers, long, long, long ago, the retail clerks were actually negotiating with them. Shavers said we couldn't afford it, opened the books, and the retail clerks all took a pay cut to make sure the Shavers would stay alive. Unfortunately, not long enough. It's not with us anymore.
I understand. So it may be necessarily contentious because you have two sides that want something from their standpoint, but it doesn't have to be argumentative.
No, I don't think it has to be argumentative. Often, the attitude that you see in the workplace is argumentative because both sides want something, and both sides think they are justified in what they're asking for. And it's only through fact-finding and instances or mediation where they can get past those impasses. Our public sector unions in Nebraska are not allowed to strike, and they have a process when they reach impasse where the Commission of Industrial Relations comes in and figures out what needs to be done.
And then briefly, you look into a crystal ball. What is the status of labor and labor unions in Nebraska and Iowa and the country?
I think every person who sells his or her intelligence, experience, and strength to an employer to earn a living deserves that meaningful democracy I referred to earlier. Without it, you have at-will employment. At-will employment, of course, is the default. And in at-will employment, an employer may discipline you for a good reason, a bad reason, or no reason at all, as long as they don't violate certain federal guidelines. And it's interesting to note that those guidelines, like the Title VII of the Civil Rights Act, minimum wage, unemployment insurance, all of those were enacted over the objection of employers who didn't like them because they directly and indirectly raised the cost of doing business. Right. And I don't know any employer who has said, oh, please, yeah, pass a law. I really, really, really want to make sure there's a level playing field and all my competitors regulate child labor just the way we do.
All right. So, hey, John, thanks very much for joining us this morning. Nice history lesson and perspective as well.
Thank you much. Appreciate it.
Up next, we're looking at another labor issue on this Labor Day weekend, the challenge of trying to find skilled labor to do jobs like plumbing and electrical work. Why so few young people choosing this path, and the local college eager to get them on the right track and into a high-paying, stable job. You're watching KETV News Watch 7's Chronicle, and this morning we're taking a closer look at the state of labor in America. Many companies tell us one of the biggest problems they're seeing is a lack of skilled workers. People can do plumbing, welding, even electrical work. And while those jobs are and will be in high demand, the future of modern work in America is changing, as Mike Householder shows us.
The workers of today are using the machines of tomorrow.
I can't find.
But that's a little consolation to Herbie Mays.
It will tell.
The 62-year-old from near Cincinnati lost his job after 30 years when his company moved some production to Mexico.
I've been fighting to figure out what the best thing to do and haven't came up with no answer.
Nearby, GE Aviation is looking for workers to man machines that make jet engine parts. But Mays doesn't have the needed skills.
I really don't know what to do right now.
They forgot that it was the American worker who truly built our country.
This is the paradox of American manufacturing in 2017. Donald Trump won the presidency in part because he pledged to stop jobs going overseas.
The Rust Belt has been hammered.
But American manufacturers have actually added nearly a million jobs in the past 7 years. The problem is those jobs require specialized skills.
You cannot have an untrained person taking care of a multi-million dollar asset.
Festo is doing more than looking for workers. It's training them. The company needs employees at its Ohio facility who can monitor a robotic distribution system. So it launched two-year college apprenticeship programs, which combine engineering and computer skills.
We need the smart, intelligent young students that's coming out of these schools.
Students like 18-year-old Jalen Britton.
A lot of people say the robotics, they're going to take over the human jobs, but really the robots, they're going to enhance what we're already doing. So if you evolve with the robots that are evolving, we grow with whatever is growing.
AJ Sherman is in the final year of a four-year apprenticeship at this steel factory in Virginia. Here, humans and robots work side by side, making chainsaws, leaf blowers, and weed trimmers.
When I tell someone I'm an apprentice, the first thing they ask is, do you make money? And the answer is obviously yes, we make great money.
Of the 146 million jobs in the US, less than half of 1% were filled by active apprentices last year. Apprenticeships are far more common in European countries like Denmark. Novozymes, which makes enzymes for detergents, says automation has increased employment.
We have more jobs altogether in Denmark than we had 15 years ago.
Herbie Mays knows he may have to learn new skills. But he also needs work now to supplement his benefits.
All right, that was Mike Householder reporting. Here in Omaha, Metro Community College is doing all it can to make sure its students are ready for the changing workforce. Joining us now to talk more about that and their innovative programs is the Dean of Construction Education, Dr. Nate Berry. Dr. Berry, thanks for being here today.
Good morning.
Tell us a little bit about some of the programs, some of the classes students can take.
Absolutely. Well, we're just finishing up the largest public-private partnership construction in community college history. So we're just finishing up our Fort Omaha expansion, right. And a large portion of that is our new Construction Education Center. And that is really a center of excellence for students that want to pursue a degree in construction. And that gamut's all the way from the design concept, which might be architecture or engineering, all the way through the specialty trades like HVAC and electrical and plumbing, mm-hmm. through construction technology, all the way through the end. So we finally have this, what I consider a national state-of-the-art facility.
Nice, all-inclusive, one-stop
Absolutely.
Shop. And why did you come up with this?
Yeah, well, there's a couple of these centers across the country, but we really have the Omaha industry. At Metro Community College, we're responsive to industry. That's one of the great things about mm-hmm. the community colleges. We work so closely with the Omaha community that a number of years ago, the construction industry and the special trades industry, manufacturing, stepped up and said, we need to do something for this skilled labor. Hence the concept, and now we are a few days from opening it up.
Yeah, so are the companies, I assume they're appreciative of what you're doing? Or do they have any input in your curriculum?
Absolutely. We have robust advisory councils in every one of our skilled trade areas. So we sit with them multiple times a year where they can provide input as far as this is the technology we're using. These are the new tools that students need to learn. This is the communication, the terminology that has come on board, so that mm-hmm. that way the students that enter our class are hearing exactly what they need to use when they get out into the workforce.
And that's what I ask you about. When a student comes into the classroom, yeah. what is expected of them?
Yeah, that's our student at MCC, if you looked at it, our average age of our student is 27, but if you walked into our Construction Education Center, mm-hmm. you might see a 16-year-old that's in part of our high school academy that's just dabbling into the construction field, or you might see a 65-year-old retiree that wants some basic electricity classes to do stuff at their home. So the expectations are simple. We want them to be safe. We want them to get excited about the industry that they're working in. And we want them to understand that it is a career path that they can have. They can provide them multiple opportunities and multiple avenues, whether they want to work for a large company or whether they want to be an entrepreneur. So the expectations are fairly simple. Be excited about what you're doing, be safe, and take something back for the community.
Okay, so that's expected of them.
Yeah.
What should their expectations be of when they graduate?
Absolutely.
High-paying job or what?
Absolutely. And we have a history of success, which is why I think industry was so excited to partner with us in these projects, is that our students, especially in the career and technical fields, they're getting jobs, if not when they graduate, before they graduate. And that's what's been exciting.
So they know exactly where they're going even before they get out of
school. Absolutely. And we work very
cool.
closely with the industry. And industry understands the value of education, too, not only after they have their associate degree, but for the continuing education that has to go on. So industry is really good about providing internships or part-time employment while they're going to work. And then once they graduate, pulling them in a full-time employment.
And I assume when you go into the classroom, it's hands-on,
Absolutely.
Right? I mean, it's not just
yep.
sitting there reading a book.
Yes, and that's what, we've been offering career and technical classes at MCC for a number of years.
Right.
But finally, we have a center of excellence. And that's what's really exciting about the new facility is we don't have a traditional classroom space and a traditional industrial lab space like you're picturing the old high schools back in the corner. What we have are learning laboratories.
Right.
And they're bright and they're open. And they allow students to understand the theory and then immediately turn around and get the hands-on practice that they need.
Nice. And you have a website. You can click on the programs
yeah.
To see if they're right for you, if it's a right fit. How can you tell if something is a right fit before
yeah,
you even go?
Exactly. So, of course, the internet is going to be the first line of defense for everybody. So
right.
they can go to the MCC website. But what we encourage students or parents or anybody to come take a tour. We have enrollment navigators, we have advisors. Myself, I'm more than happy to give tours. So we have a number of people because that career exploration is really what we want people to do. And that's why we've started a robust high school academy, with the local high school. So students that are in their junior or senior year mm-hmm. that are starting to think I might want a career in the trades, they can spend the afternoons with us in our classrooms, and maybe they spend a quarter in the basic electricity class, but they start to hear what the architecture students are doing. So then they can go dabble in that. So what they're able to do is that career exploration. So when they graduate high school, they know the path they want to go down.
So they get exposure to
Absolutely.
All the, that's awesome. Is it something where a person, say the 62-year-old, is not retired, they can work full-time and then still do this?
Absolutely. We've always had the most students in the evenings at 5:30, 6 o'clock at night, because our students do work full-time, or the students that are working part-time are working during the day and then coming to us for the evening classes.
Say someone's watching this, is inspired, they're thinking, hey, I want to look into this. Is it too late for them? I mean, you said you're about to open up.
Absolutely not. Our classes begin, our fall quarter begins Tuesday, September 5th. Yeah. But people are still enrolling now. The classes are filling up quickly, which we're excited to see. But just like I said, how we're responsive to industry, when we have to open up more sections, or we run a quarter system, so our winter quarter will start the beginning of December. We offer similar courses then, too.
What would you say to someone who is not sure if they should even take that step, even should examine this as a possible?
Yeah. Take 45 minutes and come see the facility. Talk to one of our enrollment navigators about all the different career explorations, and we can get them in contact with an industry professional. So if they have an idea of a career they think they might want to go into, mm-hmm. we'll connect them with a one-on-one individual that's been doing that career for 10, 15, 20 years, and they can ask him the hard questions.
Sounds like a great program.
Yeah,
it's just
excited.
Opening up. So,
Hey,
Dr. Berry, thanks very much.
Thank you.
You bet. Well, we're going to be right back with some final thoughts. First, though, you know your comments, they're an important part of the show. Last week, for example, Jan Anderson emailed us. She said the story this morning on the history of the Henry Dorley Zoo was wonderful. Thank you for the efforts of all who were involved with making it. We'll definitely be buying the book. That was with Dr. Eileen Worth. It was a fabulous show. If you want to be heard, email your comments to news@ketv.com. Love hearing from you, and we will be right back. Welcome back to KETV News Watch 7's Chronicle. This morning, we've been talking about the state of labor, state of skilled trades, the future of labor unions in Nebraska and Iowa. Happening right now is Omaha's Salute to Labor, Septemberfest. It runs through Monday. Highlights today include a barbecue and a ribeye steak cook-off challenge. There's midway carnival rides. There's live music. The parade, that's tomorrow morning at 10, features 80 entries, 5 large Macy's parade-type balloons. Goes through downtown, begins at 16th and Cass, heads down 16th to 10th and Capitol, and then ends at 10th and Mike Fahey by the ballpark. It's all followed then by an All-American car show. Remember, if you missed any part of this show or you want to watch it again, it's online right now at KETV.com. Just go to our homepage, click on the menu button, and look for Chronicle. I'm Rob McCartney. Thanks for watching. We'll see you back here next Sunday morning for KETV News Watch 7's Chronicle. Want to leave you this morning with a piece from our chief photographer, Scott Buehr, who captured some pretty spectacular sunsets recently.